Welcome to Hop Radio, an NDTV Hop Life production.
Hello and welcome to Combating Coronavirus, a podcast where we talk about the response to the coronavirus crisis throughout the world in various countries. And today we'll be talking about New Zealand. Now, I'm Deepit Maggi.
And I'm Priyanka Pant.
Now, as of recording this, it has 1,239 cases, and only one death has been reported so far. This is as of 9th April.
Yeah, and it's important to note right now that New Zealand is a country of 5 million people. Now, compare that to the city of Delhi. We were in the process of researching for this piece, looking at the numbers. The official census from 2011 puts Delhi's population at approximately 11 million. And the UN numbers, I believe, Dipit, was about...
The UN estimated 30 million by 2020, which are, of course, estimates, but it should be around there.
Yeah, absolutely. So compare, you know, the city of Delhi versus the entire country of New Zealand. So obviously, you know, there's lots of differences there. But I think their approach in how they've sort of tackled the pandemic is quite fascinating. And there is a fantastic piece in the Washington Post on the 7th of April, which looks really deeply at how New Zealand isn't just flattening the curve, they say they're squashing it. And that approach, I think, is fascinating in light of how other countries around the world are dealing with it, including India.
Right. So what we've seen so far in countries like Italy or Spain or the US, where the crisis has been really bad, is that the response was gradual. They locked down a few things, they shut off a few things, they shut off restaurants, then they moved to shutting off, schools and stuff like that. And finally, only now that the crisis is at its worst now, that they've decided to shut down the entire country. So they sealed their borders and they prevented all workplaces from functioning and asked everyone to stay at home except essential service workers. And they did this on the 26th of March.
And for 4 entire weeks. I mean, that's pretty interesting, right? It's 2 full 14-day incubation cycles. In India, we've done a 21-day lockdown. They're in the process of a 4-week lockdown, and they've already talked about potentially extending it in New Zealand. But of course, that there's a flip side to that. New Zealand's own health minister, the person that was leading this sort of battle against the pandemic, came under severe criticism because he took his family to the beach. I mean, in the middle of a lockdown, while you're telling people to stay home, he decided it would be a really good idea to take his family to the beach. He then was publicly chastised. He offered to resign.
Yeah, then the Prime Minister said that she would accept the resignation in a normal scenario. And this was a dereliction of duty or whatnot. But resigning him would actually be detrimental to the effort against COVID-19. So she decided to not do it. However, she did demote him in ranking in the cabinet. So he's the lowest ranked cabinet minister now. She also took away an additional ministry that he had. So he has been reprimanded in some way. He continues to hold charge of the COVID-19 efforts because, of course, he's the point person. But he was well criticized in the New Zealand press. Now, there are challenges going forward that the Washington Post article also talks about. New Zealand is an economy much that depends a lot on tourism. Famously, a very pretty country. Lord of the Rings was shot there, which increased its tourism quite a lot. Now, most of New Zealand's cases have been people who have come from abroad. They've been able to prevent community spread by a large margin. There is very little community spread that they've had. So essentially, the doctor that they quote in the article says that New Zealand will not be able to completely open up its borders until a vaccine for COVID-19 is fully made. Now, that can take up to 12 to 18 months, as we know. So the challenge for New Zealand now will be how to figure out what to do when it's not getting the income from tourism that it normally gets, and it will not get for another 1.5 to 2 years.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that's one of the many challenges that a country like New Zealand faces. You know, how do you decide economy versus anything else? I was reading another article in The Guardian, which said that New Zealand is expecting a 12 billion New Zealand dollar drop in tourist spending in just the next 6 months. Many companies have zero incomes, but what do you do? You know, at this point, clearly nobody is going to be going on holiday anytime soon. So definitely, I mean, that's going to be a huge challenge, I think, going forward. But I think number one is, you know, keeping people safe and healthy in a pandemic. Are there lessons to be learned from the way that New Zealand is dealing with it, how their government is dealing with it, how their healthcare is dealing with it? Definitely looks like it, according to the research that's coming out.
Yep, I think it's been even accounting for all the advantages they have in terms of their population, in terms of their size, they've done a pretty good job of handling it. And of course, there are lessons to be learned. So that was all about New Zealand, but we like to end on a good note. So every episode, we're trying to focus on one good story around this COVID-19 crisis. And today we have Bhasha Mukherjee, who was the Miss England pageant winner in 2019. She is also a doctor by profession, and she has recently given up her crown to return to work as a doctor.
Yeah, I thought this was absolutely fascinating. You know, she's only 24 years old at this point. She was actually doing some charity work here in India when she heard from her colleagues in the UK talking about how understaffed they were, how overwhelmed they were with all the cases pouring in. And that's when she decided to sort of go back home, you know, quarantine herself for 14 days because, of course, she's been abroad. And then, yeah, return to duty. And I think that's so fantastic. Such a great story to hear. You know, I think at this point, we're all so desperate just for some sort of good news that I think it's great to hear stuff like this.
Yep. And of course, with healthcare systems being, you know, overloaded around the world, every doctor can help. So good to see. So that was this episode of Combating Coronavirus. I hope you guys liked it. If you do feel you have any suggestions about what we should cover, do let us know in the comments. Until next time, that's us.